Kepler's second law states that planets sweep out equal areas in equal times. Let's take a look. So if we have this planet here closer to the sun than it is when it's over here, because it's closer, the force due to the sun is going to be greater, and so it's going to be moving with a faster velocity right here, a faster speed, okay? So it's moving quick right here, zipping around right here, but when it gets over here, because it's so far away from the sun, it's not going to be moving as fast. The sun is going to be pulling on it less, and so it's going to be moving slower over here as a result. And so the trajectory might go something like this in time-lapse fashion. Whenever it's over here at aphelion, it's moving slow, just snail's pace, crawling along, but then it's speeding up because it's getting closer and closer to the sun, and it's moving the fastest when it's right here at perihelion. And then it's, you know, it zips around, and then it slows down, it's moving slower and slower until it reaches aphelion, and it's moving at its slowest, and then so on. Okay? Something like that. You can look for some animations online to see a better description of that, or more accurate time-lapse fashion. Okay, so Kepler argued that the time rate of change of the planet, right, of the area that the planet sweeps out must be equal to a constant value. Because look, whenever the planet is here, it's hauling the mail, it's zipping along. So in some time interval, delta t, it's going to cover some arc length, right? And so a line connecting from the sun to the planet is going to sweep out a big area, right? Okay, but whenever the planet gets over here, it's moving slower, and so it covers a smaller arc length, and so delta theta is small, but the radius from here all the way to here compensates for that, such that it sweeps out an equal amount of area, okay? And so this is the law, equal areas and equal times. Okay, so we can use that to deduce something very useful for solving problems. Let's find the angular momentum of that planet over there at this, you know, distance away here. So the angular momentum is equal to r cross p, right? Where r is the distance from the axis to the particle in question. And it's the vector from the sun to the particle. And then p is the momentum, right? The linear momentum. So we know that only the perpendicular component of the linear momentum will contribute in the cross product. We're going to label this r right here. And then let's draw the linear momentum. It has a velocity that's off like that, right? Which results, you know, mv results in some linear momentum like this. And if we find its components, it has components like this. This is p radial, we'll call it. And also it has a p perpendicular, right? And the perpendicular means that it's perpendicular to that moment arm. So this is p perpendicular. Okay, well, it's only this perpendicular component of the momentum that contributes. So this is r times p perpendicular. So now we're just going to drop the vectors and just realize, of course, that the right-hand rule says that it's moving, you know, of course it's moving around this way. And the right-hand rule says that the angular momentum will be out of the board, okay? So then we can substitute for p perpendicular, we can put in mv perpendicular, right? Because this is just mv perpendicular. So put mv perpendicular. But then for v perpendicular, we can substitute in omega r, because we know that whenever something is out some distance r and it's moving with some angular velocity, that the perpendicular velocity to that moment arm, right, is given by omega r. So we can put r times m times omega r, like this. So let's rearrange things a little bit. We'll pull the m out front, and then we'll say this is r squared omega, like this. Okay? Now let's consider, that'll be our first equation, and yeah, let me just separate it like this. Now let's consider the area of this triangle here. Okay, for the non-calculus folks, fret not. It's not, you know, a huge leap. But we're going to consider a small change in arc length, right? And we're going to call that ds. D
ds is an infinitesimal amount. It's just a small amount of length, okay? And then we know that that is equal to r d theta, right? From the classic equation, you know, s equals r theta for a circle. Okay, we're just going to extend it to this ellipse because it's such a small distance. And then if we want to calculate the area of this triangle, the area of a triangle, I'm going to call it dA because it's a small amount of area, is equal to 1/2 the base times the height. Well, the base of that triangle is the dS, right? So rd theta. So we can put that in for the base of the triangle. And what's the height of the triangle? Well, the height is just going to be equal to r. So we put that in for r like this. And so this is equal to 1/2 r squared d theta, combining the r's. Okay, so this occurs over some, you know, amount of time, right? So we can divide by dt on both sides, get the time rate of change for the area and the time rate of change for the angle. And then this, notice, this is just, what's d theta dt? That's just equal to omega. So this is 1/2 r squared omega. All right. Now from this equation, we can eliminate r squared omega between both of these two, and it will yield a powerful result. So from this equation, we can say that r squared omega is equal to, look, we just divide by m, so it's L over m. Like this. And so we'll make that substitution in for this thing. Okay, so then this is equal to, and then 1/2 times L over M is L over 2M, right? And so this is equal to dA dt. But Kepler stated previously that the time rate of change for the areas that planets sweep out equal areas and equal times, right? That the time rate of change of the area swept out is equal to a constant value. So he concluded that the angular momentum for a planet, L, must be equal to a constant value also. So the conclusion was that L naught must always be equal to L final, unless there's some outside force acting, which there's not, okay? There's only the force of the planet acting centrally. It's a central force problem, okay? And this result will be useful because you can say, with this result, you can say M R naught V naught is equal to M R final V final, right? And so you'll be given some information, you know, it's at this distance moving this fast or whatever, you know, or it has this angular velocity at this moment. And so, you know, that will give you enough information to get this stuff over here because V is equal to omega R naught. And then, you know, you'd be asked to find the final velocity later or something, you know, underline what you know, circle what you don't, solve. Okay, see you next time.